with Woodrow Wilson in the White House after Theodore Roosevelt, the oligarchy continued to own the government. Still, the oligarchy wanted more. The oligarchy always wants more. It wanted to own America more directly. It wanted the complete private ownership of America's currency. This objective was achieved with the Federal Reserve Act in 1913, on the day before Christmas. But this wasn't easily accomplished. The greenback national currency that had fostered unprecedented economic development couldn't simply be scrapped and be replaced with the notoriously corrupt system of private money as a currency. The business elite knew, at least some did, where America's prosperity was anchored. And those in the know would have assured that the planned theft of the American national currency would not happen. The oligarchy was evidently well aware of this obstacle to their plan, and that it had to be dealt with in the typical fashion, although through the back door. One couldn't simply arrest a business elite and give it the Socrates treatment the normal way. Other means had to be found. As it was, three of the most prominent of the American elite had been individually lured onto the hyped-up maiden voyage of the Titanic. The three targeted men had been widely known in the business community. They were chosen by the Aristotelians to deliver a message to the rest. One of the men who came onto the Titanic was John Astor, the richest man of America, a businessman and real estate developer famous for the Astoria hotels. The second man was Benjamin Guggenheim, a son of the famous industrialist Mayor Guggenheim, head of a $500 million enterprise. The third man was Isidor Strauss, a German-born American businessman and co-owner of Macy's department store. He was also a politician who had served as a member in the U.S. House of Representatives. These men were not easy pushovers, but as I said, they could be used to deliver the needed message that any form of opposition in the business community against the currency privatization plan is futile, so don't stand in the way. The message was forged on the Titanic. It was there where the selected three men got the Socrates treatment, the modern way. They became trapped in the process of sinking the ship. And to make sure that the message was understood correctly in America, that the sinking in which the men died had been a planned operation. The sinking had been timed to occur on the anniversary day of the assassination of Abraham Lincoln, and this almost to the hour. Abraham Lincoln had been shot at 10:15 p.m. on April the 14th in 1865. He died of his wounds on the next day at 7:22 a.m. The Titanic, in comparison, was assassinated at 11:40 p.m. on the anniversary day of that event, and it too died on the next day. this amazingly close coincidence of the sinking of the Titanic, of an unsinkable ship, synchronized almost to the hour with a significant historic event, suggests that the sinking of the ship had been a carefully planned and managed operation, rather than a freak accident, as the world was made to believe. The message that this wasn't an accident was evidently understood in America. It was understood that resistance to the oligarchy's objectives is futile. It became rather obvious that the oligarchy has the upper hand and gets what it wants, and that no one can stop it. Actually, the ship that was sunk was not the brand new Titanic. It wasn't the style of the time to sacrifice a major asset. It was her sister ship, the Olympic, that was sunk instead. The Olympic had sustained deep structural damages in a collision with a naval vessel that the Olympic was wrongfully blamed for. This was followed up by large legal bills. Although the Olympic had been superficially repaired, it couldn't be repaired completely. It sailed with a 2.5-degree port lisp, and a potential defect that had caused it to throw a propeller plate on a voyage from New York. However, as the ship couldn't be fully repaired, it could be disposed of for a profit by sinking it, so that the insurance would take the loss. There were small design differences that set the Olympic and the Titanic apart. These differences certify that the sunken ship is the Olympic. When the two ships lay at dock in the home shipyard, the names were swapped. False names were inscribed on plates that were mounted over the original names. Many years later, underwater exploration had discovered a place where a nameplate had fallen off. It reveals letters inscribed below that are a part of the word Olympic. Captain Smith, the captain of the Olympic, was likely called to his boss one day for a thrashing. "You scoundrel, your negligence turned a prime asset into a huge liability that may sink the company. It has been decided, therefore, from way up high, to sink the ship to save the company, and that you will be the captain of this voyage. You owe us. Of course, you don't have the option to say no." "But the ship is unsinkable," Smith may have replied. "No, it will sink. We have special operatives on board who will take care of the details. Your job is to stand aside to let it all happen. The passengers will be rescued, of course, by a special rescue ship that will be stationed nearby. Everything is prepared. Everything is ready. You will sail the Olympic on the 10th of April, and you will sail it under its new name, the Titanic. The ship has already been renamed, and with the Titanic being a new ship, it has been insured as a new ship. This means that you will sail the Olympic as the Titanic's maiden voyage. The maiden voyage has been sold to sail on April 10. The Olympic has been refurbished for this to look like a new ship. You will be proud of the new ship. Is this understood?" But this is fraud, the captain may have protested. No, it isn't fraud, his boss may have replied. This is big fraud. But the bigger the fraud gets, the more it is protected from high places, because when it gets really big, many of the high echelon will profit from it too. Apparently, even the Prime Minister agrees with the plan. The government needs our ships in times of war, and it needs us to run them. If the captain had understood American history, the April 10 sailing day would have caused alarm bells to ring in his mind. But this didn't happen. The captain was a little man, faithfully obedient. Some of the known details about the sinking of the ship confirms that the sinking had been a well-planned operation from the beginning. The lookout team, as the ship entered the ice region, had been given no binoculars to work with. The binoculars had been kept under lock and key. Of course, the bridge officer Murdoch, the master of the ship at the time, would have had the finest binoculars available. He would have seen the iceberg a long way off from his lofty vantage point at the bridge. He would have seen it in the dark, protruding over the low fog that lay on the water. He could have steered the ship safely around the iceberg. But this wasn't his job. His assigned task was to sink the ship. He was evidently one of the special operatives on board who were trained to carry out a specific part of the plan. As his assigned task required, Murdoch adjusted the course of the ship with a collision in mind. The most difficult part of the plan may have been to get the timing just right. President Lincoln had been assassinated at the end of the day, less than 2 hours before midnight. This means that the sinking of the ship had to occur within a narrow window of time close to midnight, but still within the anniversary day of the assassination of President Lincoln, or else the punchline would be lost, and it would have to be as close as possible in time to the original event for the biggest effect. It appears that high-level special operatives had been implanted on the board of the Olympic, who would assure that the timing would meet all these requirements and be precise. The time of the collision at 11:40 p.m. was evidently a professional great achievement for an 1,800-mile journey with two stops along the way. The ship had a cruising speed of 39 kilometers per hour and a maximum speed of 44 kilometers per hour. The small difference in speed left little room for adjustments. As it was, the ship had received several updates of the iceberg locations intended as a warning. But with a margin as small as it was, the ship likely had to run at top speed for most of the time, even into the iceberg-infested waters. When the iceberg was officially sighted by the lookout crew at 11:38 p.m., Officer Murdoch ordered a hard-aged starboard command. Starboarders decide where the iceberg was located. He swung the ship directly into it. The maneuver would have been intended to maximize the resulting pressure of the ship against the ice. The planned sinking required massive damage to be incurred. The ship was 883 feet long, divided into 16 watertight compartments. To sink the ship, Officer Murdoch needed the iceberg to break through the side plates of the ship and flood 5 of the forward compartments. This meant gouging a 270-foot-long series of gaps through the side plates of the ship. With only 4 compartments flooded, the ship would have remained afloat. It would have survived a full head-on collision with an iceberg. Murdoch was evidently assigned no easy task to sink that unsinkable ship. The subsequent Hard A Port command that was issued by Murdoch when the iceberg was right in line with the bridge was likely intended to increase the ship's pressure against the ice further in the rear in order to keep the damaging effect up for as long as possible. As it was, Murdoch succeeded well. Five compartments were flooding. A sixth compartment may have also been flooding. Its flooding may have been contained temporarily with the watertight doors. In this case, the damage to the ship had likely extended to over 300 feet. Such extreme measures evidently had to be taken to assure that the most critical part of the plan would succeed without fail, on which everything else depended. When Captain Smith entered the bridge 5 minutes after the collision, he noticed that the ship's normal port lisp of 2.5 degrees had become a starboard lisp of 5 degrees. He probably couldn't imagine the extent of the damage that can have such a large effect in so short a time. He stopped the engines. This was all he could do. He restarted them later at half speed, probably out of defiance, but then stopped them one final time. That the sinking was not an ordinary sinking, but was designed to also facilitate an assassination, became glaringly evident in the lifeboat policy. The policy was women and children only. By this policy, many boats were launched half empty. The policy was evidently designed to keep the male passenger on the ship so that he would go down with the ship. The policy assured that the 3 targeted men, Astor, Guggenheim and Strauss, would not survive. The special operative in this case who carried out the lifeboat policy was Second Officer Lightoller. He was given a task, but he was likely unaware that the task was to assure that the planned assassination would happen. The women and children only policy that he strictly enforced was the chosen means towards this end. The fact that the ship, which was designed to carry 64 lifeboats, was equipped with only 20, had enabled the woman and children only policy to be implemented. The policy was so strictly enforced by Officer Lightoller that in one case, two men were ordered out of a less than full lifeboat by him personally at gunpoint. It was said that the men had to wait till the rescue ship would arrive that had evidently been promised to the captain and had been spotted as a light on the horizon. The light had appeared at 12:27, a few minutes before the lifeboats were made ready for loading. Had the few lifeboats that the ship did carry been loaded to capacity and then some, up to 1,000 more people would have survived. But saving the people isn't the nature of a trap. As it was, the light on the horizon went out 1 hour and 20 minutes after it was first seen. At this point, all the lifeboats had been dispensed. That's when Captain Smith realized that he had been betrayed and had been drawn into a monstrous trap, and that he himself had thereby betrayed the men on the ship. At this late point, after 1:48 a.m., he and his officers made a desperate attempt to call the half-empty lifeboats back to take on more passengers, but to no avail. Their effort was abandoned 20 minutes later. 13 minutes after the captain gave up, at 2:20 a.m., the ship, the Olympic named the Titanic, was gone. In this manner, the execution of Astor, Guggenheim and Strauss was accomplished. 1,500 people died with the ship. The three men for whom the trap was set up were among them. Officer Murdoch was also among the victims. The actual rescue ship, the Carpathia, did not arrive for 1 hour and 40 minutes. It rescued the 700 in the lifeboats. The only ship that had been closer than the Carpathia was the Californian of the Conrad Line. It was stuck in an ice field just 20 miles north. It had been shut down for the night, including its wireless office. When the first SOS call was issued by the Olympic, 15 minutes after midnight, the message was not received. This may have been the underlying reason why the sinking of the Olympic was timed to occur close to the midnight hour, so that the SOS call from the Olympic could be delayed until after the Californian's wireless office was closed. The SOS call had been delayed by over 30 minutes after the sinking began, and the launching of distress rockets by 30 minutes till 47 minutes after midnight. The rockets were seen by the crew of the Californian. Captain Lord was roused out of bed. He determined that the rocket's color was not of the distress type, but of a type that is used for intership communication. Evidently, the Olympic did not have any actual distress rockets on board. For the oligarchy, the sinking of the Olympic under the name Titanic was a splendid success that met all the key objectives. Functionally, the sinking was staged as a powerful mental trap, because the more unbelievable it all appears in the mind, the more powerful its numbing effect becomes in the mind by the realization that it was actually done. As it was, the Californian did come to the rescue after it had worked its way out of its ice field. When it arrived on the scene, it found only dead bodies remaining, floating in the water. The world was shocked by the great tragedy. But could anyone see the larger trap that stood behind it? Maybe some of the business elite in America did, who became cowards by their realization of it. It appears that a message from the Titanic had been heard in America in some form and had been understood to some degree. It had been understood that resisting the oligarchy is futile. No resistance was offered in America after the sinking of the Titanic to prevent the privatization of its currency. The theft of the currency by the privatization of it became law in the next year in the form of the Federal Reserve Act. With this deed done, America was trapped. It remains trapped to the present day.